That's yesterday. And we had a whole morning together. It was really special. He flew in from Singapore and somewhere else, Vietnam, I think. But he'd just been in Asia ministering at Joseph Prince's church last weekend. And they've known each other for 30 years. But he's been married 50 years. And his wife had to fly back to their home in the Gold Coast. And I thought, that's pretty amazing. 50 years. Come on, guys. It might be more now. Might be more. But we just talked about the kingdom and the king and the work of God in Australia. And, you know, he's a real, probably one of the foremost people who are most knowledgeable about what's happened in our Christian heritage. The light horsemen, the moves of God in the Aboriginal communities, the moves of God right across this nation. Pockets of where there's been faith and revival that have broken out. And that's the reason why we wanted to have Cole to come to our church. We have a lot of apostles that come through this church and prophets. Many of them from America, and we love Americans, amen. But we want to hear Aussie voices. We want to hear what God's doing in this nation. We want to hear what His heart is for this nation. We want to pick up the heart of the fathers. When we were singing about the fathers and sons this morning, I thought of Cole and how many sons he has that have planted churches around the nations. He fathered a church in Darwin for over 20 years. It's a thriving church to this day. And out of that church came many sons who've planted churches all over the nation and overseas. And I just think he's a father we can listen to and learn from and support and get behind. And so I'm going to let him talk about his books because I don't know enough about them to do it justice. But let's welcome Cole with a Jubilee welcome this morning. Thank you so much.
Thank you. You can be seated. Praise God. Morning. Good morning. Enjoyed the praise and worship. That was awesome. That was great. That was awesome. Thought I was back in our own church. No, that's awesome. Great to be here. Praise the Lord. Good things are happening. Praise God. My wife would have loved to have been here, but anyway, be here next time. We've just had some great meetings overseas. Awesome. Love going overseas. It's something special, but there's something special about Aussie. Can I have an amen? I'm a fifth generation Aussie, so I can say some things. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Let's just look to the Lord. Father, we just give you praise and glory. What awesome days it is to be alive and serving you. Father, I just thank you for your grace and your favor that's on our lives, our homes, our families, and on our nation. And Father, it's not by might, it's not by power, it's certainly not by our brilliant intellects, but it's by your spirit. Just thank you for it, Lord. Just give you the praise and the glory. Holy Spirit, you're welcome here. Father, as smart as we are and as smart as we think we are, as anointed, but without your grace, we won't make it. We just won't make it without your grace. Thank you for your grace. We just give you the praise and the glory for that. Awesome God. Lord, people are looking for peace in bottles and pills and places, but peace is a person. It's you. Thank you, Jesus. You are our peace. In a troubled world, you are our peace. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Open your Bibles with me, if you would, to Romans. Just want to thank Pastor for the privilege, the honor that it is to share the Word of God. Never take it for granted. You know, he was talking about love Americans. We pastored in California for a few years. And lovely people, beautiful, but I would have crawled over glass to come home again. There's no place like this. I might be, may not be the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I believe this is the greatest country in the world. I honestly believe that. I'm not just saying things. I honestly believe that. And I love it that Wigglesworth had prophesied the last great move of the Holy Ghost. Would not be in America, would not be in England, not be in Europe, but would be in Australia, New Zealand, and the islands of the Pacific. I love that. Some people have challenged that, but I've actually had two eyewitnesses who are still alive that actually heard that. Wow. Mama Jenkins, she just died recently, 103 years old. Still driving a car at 95. Awesome. And we saw her at a Kenneth Copeland conference in the States, and she said, I didn't drive, I came on the dog. I said, what's a dog? The Greyhound bus. I just love her sense of humor as well. Romans chapter 1. Forgive me, I'm sucking on an anointed mint here I'm trying to get rid of. It's anointed one though. Verse 16 says, Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. We're always looking for the power somewhere. It's always in something new, but the gospel is the power of God. To salvation, that's not just talking about deliverance from your sin. Every need that you'll ever have or will ever have was met on the cross. Is that awesome or what? Healing for your body, peace for your mind, protection, provision, unmerited favor of God. I love that. And Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. You know, some time ago, I was actually in a meeting. The Spirit of God said, do you even know what the gospel is anymore? Now, maybe it's just me, but we sort of think that anything that we preach out of the Bible is the gospel. It may be the Bible. It may be the Word of God, but it's not the gospel. The gospel is the good news. That Jesus Christ paid the price once and for all. Is that right or not? You may know all sorts of things, but if you don't understand the birth, the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you've missed the most important part of the Word of God. We may know all of these wonderful revelations, but if you don't understand the birth, the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you miss the very focal point, the entire centerpiece of the Word of God. Just bringing Jesus back as the focal point of our lives. You know, as I say, I'm a fifth generation Aussie. I love my nation. I'm not just saying, I love my nation. You know, we used to regularly go overseas. I used to go to the States twice a year. And we've been going to Asia for 35 years. I won't go there. And I'm flying over, half the flight to Asia is over Australia. And I'm flying, and the Spirit of God said, you know, son, I've actually got some people here. That's what he said to me. You know, praise God. You know, it's awesome. We send missionaries to overseas, to Afghanistan and Turkestan and Footstan and Handstan, a few other stands. And that's, I'm not knocking at it. Praise God. But Jesus wept over his own people. To Jerusalem first. And then the other. How about our own people? What about a love for our own folks? Just our own nation. I love it. We regularly go to the outback. We're in the Kimberleys, you know, Kununurra. It's not the end of the world, but you can see it from there. And I just realised what foreigners we are in our own country. I go to youth groups. Who's been to Bali? Every hand goes up. Who's been to that? Who's really been off the bitumen road in your life? Maybe 10%? Have ever really been in the outback? Anyway, you know, we're a funny mob. We really are. We're the only nation that shoots this national emblem. I mean, are we weird or what? Imagine the Americans shooting the bald eagle. We glorify our suicidal sheep thieves, waltzing Matilda. But at least we're not as bad as the Kiwis, the All Blacks. They lose their wallets before they play rugby. Anyway, we won't go there. It's okay, my pastor's a Kiwi, so... A couple of years ago, I had an invitation to come and... Actually, it was Coffs Harbour. Come and speak on Australia Day. Not a Christian. It was just organised by the council. The mayor actually invited me. And so we go there. I mean, 6,000, 7,000 people. The lady in front of me was Alicia Jane Cook, you know, formerly from Home and Away. She's talking about beer and barbecues and bikinis. You know, I'm not built the same. It's a bit of a tough act to follow. Anyway, and so it's my turn. I've got to get up. I said, you know, it's amazing. You know, we talk about Australia. No one even mentions where the name comes from. Out of 7,000 people, not one person knew where the name came from. Australia. It's actually La Australia del Espiritu Santo. I'm sorry if I'm butchering Spanish, but that's as close as I can get. Southern land of the Holy Spirit. Not greats, we added that. Southern land of the Holy Spirit. Names mean things. They may not mean much to you and I, but they mean things to God. Names indicate character. They indicate destiny. When God changed a man's name, Saul becomes Paul. Simon becomes Peter. Why? If there's no significance in names. My oldest boy is called Shane after the Western Gunfighter movie. Shane, how spiritual is that? Thick as a brick. But my second son is called Mark. Began to realize there are no other nations on the face of the earth. No nations on the face of the earth that have ever been honored with the name Land of the Holy Spirit. But we not only dishonor it, we shorten it to simply Australia. La Australia del Espiritu Santo. In 1606, a Portuguese explorer comes sailing down here. He believes that he's fulfilling the will of God on his life. He actually has a dream. And so he carves a figure of the Apostle Paul on the front of his ship. And he comes looking for the South Land. They know it's here somewhere because how many of you remember the Brits, the Dutch, the French are all sailing around it. They can't find it. It's not exactly that small that you could miss it. Is that right? But here he comes sailing, and I love this. And he arrives in Vanuatu, thinks he's found the South Land. And this is what he declares. He says, here, let the heavens and the earth, the waters with all their creatures, will all those here present witness that I, Captain Pedro Fernandez de Quiros, in the name of Jesus Christ. Not Buddha, not Muhammad, but in the name of Jesus Christ, I hoist the emblem of the Holy Cross on which Jesus Christ's person was crucified. Whereupon he gave his life for the ransom and the remedy of the human race on this day of Pentecost. This happens to be the day of Pentecost. I take possession of all this part of the south as far in the pole, as far as the pole, in the name of Jesus. He claims New Zealand, Australia, and the islands of the Pacific. The same area that Wigglesworth claims the last great move of the Holy Ghost. And he says, but now on shall be called the southern land of the Holy Spirit. And this always and forever, not till some left-wing politician decides to change it, but always and forever, to the end that all the natives in all the said lands, the holy sacred evangel, will be preached zealously and openly forever. I love that. Zealously and openly. Zealously and openly. Zealously and openly. I love that. You know, if you go to Psalm 78 with me, Psalm 78, you know, let's just talk about a couple of things for a minute, because people think when you talk about heritage, you're talking about history. If you get your dictionary out, you find there's a vast difference between heritage and history. History is the study and the events of places, events, but heritage is something of value that's passed down from generation to generation. Can I have an amen? Amen. And God's into heritage. In Psalm 78, verse 1, it says, give ear, O my people, to my law, and incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I'll open my mouth in a parable. I'll utter dark sayings of old, which we've heard and known and our fathers have told us. Well, that wasn't true in my case because my father didn't know these sort of things, so how could he pass it on? And it says, and will not hide them from their children, but telling to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and the wonderful works that he has done. Talking about the goodness of God, can I have an amen? The favor of God on our nation, the goodness of God. It says here, is that right? Telling to the next generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and the wonderful works that he has done. I don't mean to be rude, but more often or sometimes we focus on the negative. 666 and the stormtroopers are coming to get us. It says, talk about the goodness of God. There's never been a war fought on our land. Every European nation, is that right or not, has had blood. There's never been a war fought on our land. That's not because we're better or smarter. I believe there's a grace on our nation. And it goes on to say, for he established the testimony in Jacob, not Esau. Esau was the firstborn, but Esau sold his heritage. Is this correct or am I pulling this out of? God actually says, Jacob, I love, Esau, I hate it. Now that's pretty strong. Hebrews, New Testament. Is that right? Hate it, he says. He says, established the testimony in Jacob, and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that the generations to come might know them, the children who would yet be born. Why? So they may arise and declare them to their children. Why? So they may set their hope in God. Is that right? And not forget the works of God. I like that. You know, talking about the goodness of God, the grace of God. A few years ago, my wife comes from a German background, and wonderful people. You know, she grew up in a Catholic church. I grew up in nothing. I just love the values of her family generation. You don't tell lies. I could lie with the best of them. You pay your bills. There's a novel idea today. She wasn't even allowed to buy anything unless she could actually pay for it. No time payment, anything like that. They weren't even born again. There's something, you know, that heritage passed down from Jed. So we're going back to Germany to find where her dad had come from. Her grandfather fought in the German army. My grandfather fought in the Australian Light Horse. They maybe even fought each other. So we're going back to see where that family had come from. We arrive in Charles de Gaulle Airport, Paris, France. I'm not a good flyer. 20-hour flight, lights on, but nobody's home. Arms like orangutans from carrying my wife's bags, pulled out of the sockets. Anyway, I get off the flight and I'm just standing. I'm comatose. And I'm just standing and minding my own business, and an L-hour flight touches down from Tel Aviv. And the doors open, 50, 60, 100 Orthodox Jews. Anybody know what an Orthodox Jew? Black hat, black ringless, black overcoats, black beards. You don't need a word of knowledge. I wonder if these are Irish tourists or something. They're Orthodox Jews. And they're walking past me, and I'm just minding my own business. And the Spirit of God spoke to me. He said, son, they've not lost or sold their heritage in 2,000 years without a country. Scattered to the diaspora, to the four corners of the earth, but they've never lost or sold their heritage. They may be Russian, but they're still Russian Jews. They may be American, but they identify as them. Is that right or not? Hello. You know, by contrast, we don't even have to leave our nation. Our young people are losing their heritage. I feel the love's going to come there. We talk like Americans. We act like, and I'm not anti-American, but I don't want a second-hand heritage. Can I have an amen? I think that's wonderful, but I don't want some other country's heritage. I want my kids to know their own. Isn't that what it says here? Teach your children their godly heritage, why they may place their hope in God. And so I'm just standing, like I say, there, and the Spirit of God's dealing with me about that. And he said, you know why they've never lost or sold their heritage? And I said, no, but I think you're going to tell me. And he quoted me Psalm 78. If you ever get a chance, I'm sure there's plenty here in Sydney, but in Melbourne, there's a whole Jewish area that you go along and watch the Jewish fathers bring their sons. Is that right or not? On the night, Friday night, that's the Sabbath. Not the mums, but the dads. And they passed that heritage on from generation to generation. Going to have an amen or what? From generation to generation, even not Orthodox Jews. They can quote sometimes volumes of the Bible. I don't know. I love that. As I say here, I'm just sort of thinking about it. You know, and so we go to England. My wife and I, we go over to England. Cold, wet, windy summer's day in England. I've got an overcoat on. I'm from Darwin. Hello. On a beach, the most miserable excuse for a beach. No, I'm not going there. I said, this is not a beach. This is an April Fool's joke. No, I'm just joking. My mother-in-law's English. I'm not anti-English. And I'm just standing there freezing, you know. And I said, honey, this is where the Mayflower set out to colonize North America. Somewhere here, the pilgrims. And as soon as I said it, the Spirit of God said, wouldn't it be nice if you knew as much about your own country as you do some others? See, I'm not being smart. I don't even... No, I'm not a history. I don't profess to be a history, you know, doctorate. I talk to history professors. I spoke to 100 history teachers at schools. More of them got more degrees than a thermometer. Dr. Fahrenheit, hello? Hello? They speak four languages. I'm still struggling with English. And they said, what planet are you from? I said, would you like me to give you 100 books from our forefathers? I found that 99% of our founding fathers and explorers openly acknowledged some sort of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. How come I was never taught that? Our name signifies. Is that right? La Australia del Espiritu Santo. That's where the name comes from. Whether or not De Quiros landed here is irrespective. This is where the name comes from. And names indicate character and destiny. I wanted to show you a little DVD, short DVD. I go to a lot of schools and things like that, and it's a visual generation. Is that right? It needs some sort of visual impact. So this is what we show them at schools. Can you just run that, please, if you would?
Jesus says, I'll free you. I'll set you free. And we shall spend eternity with him exploring a glorious universe that he has created for us to enjoy.
Eternity! Eternity! Thus saith the High and Holy One, who inhabiteth eternity.
If that doesn't fire you up, your wood's wet. Is that right? Praise God. Go to Acts with me if you would. Acts chapter 17. How many of you believe the word of God? See, it's not what I say or you say, it's what the word of God says. Is that right or not? Just the grace of God, the goodness of God. I just love, this, you know, what God's doing in our nation, among our people. In here in Acts chapter 17, as I say, you speak to a lot of different people. They say, well, God's not really interested in nations. Well, it's funny, God doesn't know that. In Acts chapter 17, verse 26, and he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. One translation actually says, the time and nation will rise, and a time and nation will fall, even determining the boundaries of that nation. I love that. Our nation's been chosen by God. I see that God looks at our nation like a huge aircraft carrier. How come the Muslims never colonized our nation? They've been coming for hundreds of years. I'm from the Northern Territory. You can go along the coastline in Arafura. Many of the Aboriginals still have oriental features. You can see where they landed. There's still big, huge areas where they used to melt down the sea slugs, the tamarind trees they planted, but they never colonized this place. They believed that this was a place of evil spirits. The Chinese have been coming for hundreds and hundreds of years. You can still some of them, but they never colonized this place. I believe that God has saved our nation like a huge aircraft carrier to launch the gospel into the Asian, is that right, the Pacific archipelago. Here we are, this nation, is that right, in a sea of Islam and Buddhism. From our nation, the gospel was taken to New Zealand by Samuel Marsden. You know, sometimes I've spoken in New Zealand, and some of the folks said, well, Christianity was rammed down our throats. No, it wasn't. Marsden actually befriended and nursed back to health the son of a king, and it got him converted, and so he invited Marsden to bring the gospel to New Zealand. Christmas Day, they arrive. And if you go to the Bay of Islands, there's a huge cross there still marking where they arrived. And he brought the good news. Vanuatu, Solomon Islands, Fiji, New Guinea, all, is that right or not? Hello. Was planted from here, right here. A little lady called Florence Young. I've actually got photographs of her. She looks like Mary Poppins. You know, and when at the turn of the century, when the White Australia policy came in and many of those had to be shipped back, she went back with them to the Solomon Islands. They were still eating people. A little lady that looked like Mary Poppins and took the gospel to the Solomon Islands. You know, I'm not being smart, but we know so little of our own heritage. It actually bothers me. We know so little of our own heritage. You know, the same year that the Kyros is coming in from the New Hebrides, down from the north comes a man of God in a boat called the Dufkin. Dufkin is Dutch for dove, which indicates the Holy Spirit. The first contact between Aboriginal people in the Northern Territory and white folks was by a man of God, the captain of the ship, William Janszoons. And as he goes back, he started the church in Indonesia. First contact between Aboriginal and white people were with Christians. And so we can begin to see the hand of God on our nation. You know, De Quiros goes back to Spain. He's arrested and locked up and called a liar, but he writes a book. One of the people that reads his book is James Cook. And you can begin to see the hand of God on our founding fathers being passed down from generation to generation. And Cook, awesome man of God, you know, carries a Bible with him wherever he goes, takes divine services aboard the ships himself personally. He was the man that discovered how to stop scurvy in the British Navy by taking things like lemons and things aboard ship. I believe that was the wisdom of God that showed him how to handle that. And so you begin to see the hand of God. They sail into Tahiti, the Friendly Islands, You can see the program on ABC, the entire crew jump ship, go off with the local ladies. And Professor Manning Clark, certainly not a Christian, closer possibly to being actually maybe a communist. But he writes, he says, separated by 2 years and 11,000 miles, he said, there's something very romantic. And he says, honourable that of two crews that jump ship and run off with the local ladies, only one man ever stays faithful to his wife, James Cook. And the Queen of Tahiti comes aboard the ship and demands, you can get the ABC series and watch it, and demands to have sexual relationships with James Cook. He says, lady, current vernacular, do whatever you like, but it's not going to happen. I could never face my wife and my sons again. I like that. You know, just the courage, the conviction of our founding fathers. How come we were never taught that? You know, it's amazing. My grandson's just joined the army. My wife's a stickler for manners and things. She loves the manners of the southern United States. Just ma'am, no ma'am, three bags full ma'am. I mean, you got a guy 6 foot across the shoulders. He's called Bubba. Don't you love that, Bubba? I remember we're down in Tennessee, you know, and the boat's rocking like this, and my wife's on the back of the boat. She's trying to get up onto the deck. I'm down the back, thick as a brick anyway. And a 16-year-old man walks up and puts his hands out and says, can I help you ashore, ma'am? Jen goes, whoa, ho, back home in Aussie, they'd push you in. Thank you for your... And then she turned to me and she said, that's the way he was brought up. Is that right? That's the way he was raised up. Train up a child in the way he should go. You know, there's something even about that honor and passing it on. You know, let me just say this. If we lose our Christian heritage, it will have dire consequences. Extremely dire consequences if we lose our Christian heritage. The foundation of any nation is the family. Can I have an amen? When God saw that Adam was lonely, he didn't build him a church. Not real deep. Gives him a family. Can I have an amen? I believe it's God's idea. It's one of the few things you can take to heaven with you. If I was a devil and I wanted to destroy a nation, I'd take the families out first. And to take the families out, I'd take the fathers out first. And watch a nation disintegrate. Can I have an amen? You can see it right across the world, what's going on now. I mean, just look at, if you think, you better listen to what I'm saying, but, you know, maybe we've done a disservice by telling our young people all they need is the anointing. Praise God for the anointing, but you better have something more than the anointing. You better have some character for a start. You better have some integrity, a thing called honor. If you want to live long on the earth, honor your mum and dad. Marriage is honorable. Can I have an amen or what? Jesus talks about honor. If you want to just look at the difference, if you think it's just the anointing, look at the difference between Samson and Joseph. Samson's born with a spiritual silver spoon in his mouth. Judges says the angel of God, is that right? Herod his birth. That's not a bad start. He's called of God. He's blessed of God. He's anointed of God. Is that right? He has a destiny and he fulfills none of it. At the end of his life, he commits suicide serving his enemies. By contrast, Joseph is sold into slavery by his own family. I mean, if anyone had a chance to have a chip on their shoulder, surely it's Joseph. Sold nude on the slave blocks of Egypt by his own family. But he never forgets his family. Can I have an amen? Samson starts at the pinnacle and he finishes at the bottom. Joseph starts at the bottom and finishes at the pinnacle. Absolute top, is that right? Job in the most powerful nation in the face of the earth. Well, what's the difference? The Bible says they're anointed. There must be something beyond that. Look at the way they treat women for a while, for a start. Samson sees the prostitute and says, get her for me, to his dad. His dad should have boofed him in the ear. Is that right or not? Hello. By contrast, Joseph, is that right? He's living in Potiphar's house. Potiphar's married to one of the most beautiful ladies in the land. Not once, but every day, read it. She says, come and have sexual relations, every day. Joseph, 16 years old. He's got enough testosterone to jumpstart a dead buffalo. Is that too quick? And he says, it ain't going to happen. Is that right? He says, it's not going to happen, lady. No matter what you say. She rips his shirt off. Some people look at me in sheer shock. I mentor probably 50 pastors. It's not just how well you can preach, sing, tap dance, or stand on your head. There better be something else there besides. Can I have an amen? I love my family. Now, this is just me. You know, I love my family. You touch my kids, I'm driving over the top of you back up to make sure you're dead. Is this duty?
Oh, you know, and you know, my grandson's going there. I have people write up, we shouldn't do that. I said, well, isn't it funny? Jesus didn't know that. The only man he ever commends for his faith is a Roman army officer. If it's so wrong, why didn't Jesus chastise him? Is that right? Instead, he holds him up as an example. Can I have an amen? If you don't believe me, look at Nehemiah. I'm just digressing for a few moments. When it's your turn to minister, you can do it your way. In Nehemiah, I like Nehemiah. Nehemiah's my sort of bloke. You know, it's going to take some guts to be a Christian in these last days. Can I have an amen? I don't mean to be rude, but, you know, there's a lot of wussy people. When I got, I'm not exaggerating, when I got, I owned a gun shop when I got saved. I've hardly been in the church. You know, and so I fronted up to the Darwin Baptist Church. Lovely people, but I was in shock. You know, they're looking and he says, I said, what do you do? He's a missionary. I can tell by the clothes. Oh, man, we won't go there. Is that right? What do you do? I'm a school teacher. They said, what do you do? I said, I sell guns. They looked at me like I had 666 tattooed on my bum or something. You do what? Let's put them into shock. I make no excuses for it. I love my guns. I take my grandson shooting. Paul says, I am what I am by the grace of God. Some people are in shock right about now. I make no excuses for it whatsoever. You know, I think somewhere along the line we got Jesus mixed up with Mother Teresa. Well, the same man drove the money changers out of the temple with a whip. Anybody that can separate a Jew from his money's no wimp. Is that too deep? I mean, I don't know, man. I wouldn't follow a wussy wimpy. I mean, awesome man like that. Hardened fishermen just dropped what they were doing to follow him. Can I have an amen or what? You know, in Nehemiah chapter 4, you know, the heritage of his nation's in ruins for 150 years. And God speaks to one man, usually just one man, one lady. It's not a gang, it's not a mob. You know, I'm leaving later because pastor's in shock right about now anyway. But you know, we really are. So, courage is very lacking today. We've got to be a mob, we've got to be a gang before we do anything. I really believe in this last days we need people that will stand up, speak up and refuse to shut up. We need some gutsy men. Is it right to say that? My wife's a gutsy lady. I find the women got more guts than the blokes. I tell you, don't tangle with my wife. I tell you, she's a gutsy lady. I tell you before God, she is a gutsy lady. When I owned a gun shop, you know, I'm in some rough characters. And she's standing behind the door one day and this bloke comes in and he starts swearing. And my wife said, I mean, he's 6'9" or something. She went, this is our shop, just shut your mouth. He said, I'm sorry, lady, I'm sorry. It was like a Jack Russell, you know, jumping up to a greyhound or something. You touched my family, hello. My wife's a gutsy lady, I tell you. But you know, and she said, with my grandsons, the way they're being raised up, manners. She said, you'll open the door for your mother. You'll stand up. You'll open the car door for your mother, for me. You might have some problems, but wife bashing won't be one of them. You'll respect your mother. You'll respect your sisters. My grandson, second son, grandson's 15 years old. 15 years old. I was telling Pastor. He went for his first job. He's, you know, working part-time from high school. So he applies to this big company. 1,100 people apply for the job. He and two others get the job. And the company manager said, you are the youngest person we have ever employed. And he says, but I like your manners and I like your attitude. The week before we left to go overseas, he got called in the boss's office. True story, I'm not making things up. You know, called in and the boss says, we have had a letter from a lady about you, and he thinks he's going to get fired. And this lady says, I want to commend that young Jay. He has restored my faith in this generation. I said, what did you do? He said, I just was nice to her. I opened the door. I carried her things for her. Train up a child in the way he should go. When he's old, he'll not depart. Honor your mum and dad. Marriage is so much in scripture, just simply a thing called honor. Can I have an amen or what? And if we lose our Christian heritage, it will have major, major implications for this nation. Anyway. So here in Nehemiah, the heritage of his nation's in ruins for 150 years. And God speaks to him. Look at verse 13. And it says, I position men. Notice men in the italics, not boys, not teenagers. I feel a love coming there. Anyway, we won't go there. But men. In ancient societies, there's no such thing as a teenager. It's invented by Western... Get your dictionary out. It was invented by Hollywood in the 1950s. It was young men, older men. Is this correct or not? Jewish boys today become men at 13. They go through bar mitzvah. Paul says, when I was a child, I thought as a child, I acted, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. But today, because we've sort of lost that, now we have a thing we have invented called teenagers. Even another one called Peter Pan that never want to grow up. Anyway, we won't go there. So therefore, I position men at the lower parts of the wall, at the openings. And look what he says, I set the people according to their families. This is God's idea. I set the people according to their families, with their swords, with their spears, with their bows. And I looked and I rose and I said to the leaders and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, and fight for your sons, fight for your daughters, fight for your wives, and fight for your homes. I didn't say that's scripture. If ever there was a time, I really believe, for the men and women to stand up for their homes and their families, it's now. If we don't do it, what about the next generation? What is going to happen to the next generation? Can I have an amen or what? And so I learned from my founding fathers here, these men that would stand up, you know, with the first fleet. Before the first fleet leaves, how many know French go into revolution? Blood flows in the street. Voltaire makes a statement, 6 months, no one will ever even heard of the Bible. They think they're going to export their revolution to England, but God has other ideas and revival breaks out. The Wesley brothers. And one of the young men that gets swept into the kingdom is a man called the Reverend Richard Johnson. And Johnson comes aboard the first fleet. He pays his own fare. I made a mistake one time. I said he paid his own airfare. But that'd be pretty good. But he pays his own fare. But he brings the Bible. No one denies that the convicts came, but also on the same ships came the Word of God. Within a week in Botany Bay, he takes a divine service. And it talks about here how everyone was, you know, was listening with great intent as he talks about what shall we render unto God for all of the blessings that he has exhibited towards us. Let me read you what he writes, and I love this. You know, it's not just some person with a religious spirit. I love the way that he writes here. You can get his books even to this day. Here, and he writes, if I can find the page, just give me a moment. I entreat you to read the Word of God carefully. Many of you had Bibles given to you. Begin the day with prayer. If you find it impractical to meditate, to pray for the interruptions you're constantly exposed to. If you have families, you should call them together, pray with them, pray for them. There are many promises made to worshipping families, and those like Abraham endeavor to teach their children and household to know and serve the Lord their God all the days of their lives. Richard Johnson. He writes here, he says, let me find this one. I love the way that he writes, but I forgot to mark it down. Thank you, Jesus. In all his inestimable blessings are the fruit and the effect and the death and the mediation of Jesus Christ. His great design in the coming into the world was to seek and save those who are lost. He came from heaven that he might raise us to those holy, happy mansions. He endured the curse that we might inherit the blessings. Hello? He bore the cross that we might live. He died the just for the unjust that he might bring us all to God. So the Word of God comes to this nation. You know, think about that. Our founding fathers, we could go on and on. Charles Sturt, model Christian character, Professor Manning Clark calls him. A hero fighting Napoleon arrives here. Every letter, every single letter he writes to his wife starts or ends with his love for the Lord Jesus Christ. They take communion in the desert. How come we were never taught that? They think they're going to die. He says, throw away anything, but no one touches my Bible. Every day they take communion in the desert. He talks about treating the Aboriginals with respect as future, you know, sons and brothers in the Lord. He talks about these things. Think about that. Manning Clark calls him a model Christian character. I like that. So you can begin to see the hands of God. Here comes Captain James Cook taking divine services aboard. Think of some of the names, places that James Cook named. Providential Island, Trinity Bay, Whitsunday Passage. It's obvious the man's not a Hindu. So you can begin to see the hand of God passed down. But you know what bothers me? Very few of our people know anything about what I'm talking about. Very few people. I told Pastor, we just had a conference in Perth celebrating our Christian heritage. It was put on by Asian and African pastors. There was not one Australian pastor on the committee. I can say some things. I'm a fifth generation Aussie. The African pastor said, you know, I went to one of the largest church here in this city and told him, and he said, the pastor said to me, I don't want Australia to be known as a Christian country. And he said, there's something wrong with your mentality. Thank you for your enthusiasm on the point. Thank you, Jesus. But you know, here, the more that I look into the, I don't know about you, but I love this. And you begin to see the hand of God. A nation derives its character from the worship of its national heroes. Think about that. We could go on. Every school, every hospital, our freedom of speech owes its existence to Christianity. Our newspapers, our freedom of speech, our schools, our hospitals, everyone can be traced back to our Christian forefathers. If we lose our Christian heritage, it will have major, major implications for our nation. Look with me at Psalm 115 here. You know, we looked up there before, our politicians, Parks, Deakin, you know, Alfred Deakin. Deakin was the Prime Minister of his country on three occasions. He wrote a book of 600 documented prayers for this country. Most of us don't even know. Can I be honest? Most of us know more about the Welsh revivals than we do our own. Can I have an amen? Have a better amen. Let me just read you here what Parks, what Deakin writes. Just one of the prayers that he writes for this nation. He says, God, preserve this people. Grant its leaders unselfish fidelity, the courage to face all the trials for the sake of the brotherhood. Your blessing has rested upon us here yesterday, and we pray it may be the means of creating and fostering throughout all Australia a Christian citizenship. You know, sometimes I like John Laws. This is just me anyway. And he made a statement that Alfred Deakin was a spiritualist. Well, he was before he got saved. So I wrote him a letter and I said, you know, I like you so. I said, but do you want to propagate error? That's not true. And I quoted him. Deacon says here that Jesus Christ is the light of the present, the hope of the world, and my Lord and Savior. I said, does that sound like a spiritualist to you? I never even got a reply, but if he says it again, I'll get in his face again. Thank you for your enthusiasm. But we need some people with some guts. This is just me. We need people who stand up, speak up, refuse to shut up. I remember Margaret Court saying that she had dinner one time with John Howard when he was Prime Minister. He said, Margaret, we never hear from the church. It's the silent majority, the frozen chosen. You know what my wife said? We're doing some men's meetings. She said, you Aussie blokes are like Arctic rivers, frozen at the mouth. Anyway, we won't go there. Thank you for your enthusiasm. Thank you. Thank you for moving right. I love my nation. I love my nation. It bothers me what's happening to our nation. Just little by little, is that right? We're either selling or giving away our Christian heritage, undermining our foundations. Is that right? Anyway, that's what I believe. You know, just think about the hand of God. I mean, Gary Ablett, you people are into rugby here, but Aussie rules, the real football. Mr. Football, Gary Ablett, this year, the Brownlow medalist. Is that right? When he went on television, he says, I owe it all to God, my Lord. I like it. Thank you, Jesus. Can I have an amen or what? I really believe our nation needs us now. I believe our nation's right now at a crossroads, which way it goes. Have a look at the last election, how very close we came even there. I believe our nation's at a crossroads. We could decide to go one way or the other. We could continue on our Christian, or we can just go and become just a totally secular nation with no standards, no thought for God. Can I have an amen? Praise God. Anyway, this is just me. When it's your turn to preach, you can do it your way. We are custodians of our nation. I believe myself we'll give an account of what happened. Is that right or not? At least I'm... anyway, in Psalm 115, did you find that one? Psalm 115. Good, because I haven't yet. Psalm 115, and look with me in verse 16. The heavens, even the heavens of the Lord's, but the earth he has given to the children of men. What do we do with our heritage? What are we going to do in a southern land of the Holy Spirit? I really believe we'll give an account of some of those things. Even to my own kids, my own grandkids, I believe. You know, what sort of a heritage am I passing on to my kids and my grandkids? I love my kids. I love my grandkids. You know, the Bible talks about first the natural, then the spiritual. There must be some things we can learn in the natural and apply in the spiritual. You know, how many of you know that Jesus said, God said, if you bless my people, I'll bless you. If you curse my people, I'll curse you. No one has ever blessed the Jewish people more than we've blessed the Jewish people. We've saved their nation three times. First World War, how many of you know, First World War breaks out. We're 13 years old as a country, traditionally, the age when boys become men, Jewish boys. 1914, we're 13 years old as a nation. And so 45,000 of our forefathers ship out to the Middle East called the Light Horse. Every man's a volunteer. Only nation in the world, every man was a volunteer. No conscripts. My grandfather was part of that. Broke horses for the Light Horse. They ship out. We go to a place called Gallipoli. We get a blood nose straight away. And so they ship back to Egypt, re-equipped with the horses. They're assigned the protection of the Suez Canal. And eventually they start to push the Ottoman Turks back into the Sinai Desert. 1917 would be a strategic battle over maybe who would control the Holy Land for the next 100 years. The Ottoman Turks had ruled Beersheba for 400 years. It was captured on the 31st of October, 1517. It was liberated 400 years to the day, 31st of October, 1917. If you think that's coincidence, you're thick as a brick. Same day it was captured, if you want to check it out, was the day that Martin Luther nailed his declaration of faith to the cathedral wall. And so the Ottoman Turks had controlled Beersheba. Whoever controls the walls of Beersheba controlled the gateway to Jerusalem. 11 crusades, not one, 11 crusades tried for many years to liberate. And eventually they did get in.